Hi everyone, and greetings from Sony Mobile. My team works on fast separation genomics and transcriptomics from field isolates mainly. We are particularly interested in antigenic variation. But today I'm presenting a collaborative project with David Conway at the London School and others on cultural adaptation. Let me start with some definitions. A clinical isolate is a parasite taken straight from the arm of a malaria patient. This is as close to the real world as you can get. If you put this isolate into a culture flask for weeks or months, it will be called culture adapted. If you were to select an individual parasite from that population to make a clone, you then generate a lab strain. Our current knowledge of Parsimonum falciparum molecular biology is mainly derived from lab strains. In fact, just a single one of them, called 3D7. While this is, of course, great for the reproducibility of science, there is a risk that our understanding of the parasites is biased. Indeed, we previously showed that all lab strains have acquired early stop codon mutations in EPAC, also called cyclic nucleotide binding protein, and in transcription factors of the RPAP2 family. These loss-of-function mutations are never found in clinical isolates. More generally, research on the parasite response to a change in the environment may lead to key discoveries. And today, I will focus on the genomic basis of growth rates and virulence. To do so, we cultured 30 new clinical isolates, mainly from Ghana, in a culture flask for up to 7 months. Each dot represents a time point at which we performed whole genome sequencing and measured the parasite multiplication rate. First, using the whole genome sequencing data, we measured the FWS value. It's a metric calculated from the genetic diversity of an isolate. A value of 1 indicate a monoclonal or a single genotype infection, while a lower value indicates a higher number of genotypes or clones within an isolate. With time in culture, the genetic diversity in most isolates is reduced, indicating that some genotypes outcompete others. We also measured the parasite multiplication rate, which is basically a measure of the exponential growth of falciparum every 48 hours. As you can see, it is consistently increasing over time in culture. Parasites go faster and faster, but still slower than 3D7, by the way. So either there is a selection of fast grower genotypes, or these genotypes are adapting to the environment, or both. Very importantly, we previously showed that, at least within this dataset from Ghana, the in vitro parasite multiplication rate directly correlates with the parasitemia in the patient. In other words, if you have a patient with high parasitemia, you take a parasite, put it into culture, it grows fast. If you have a patient with low parasitemia, put that parasite into culture, it will grow slower. It indicates that some parasites are inherently faster growers than others. So what could drive this increase of parasite multiplication rate in vitro? Well, based on the literature, we might expect genotypes with drug resistance alleles to grow slower. That would be due to a fitness cost associated with the drug resistance. So that wild type genotypes would outcompete them during culture. However, this is not what we observed. Each line represents the allele frequency of a drug resistance marker increasing or decreasing over time in culture. So each line is from a different isolate. But there is no evidence of a selection of wild-type genotypes over drug-resistant genotypes. So we can conclude that drug-resistant genotypes do not drive the increase of parasite multiplication rates in vitro. Second hypothesis, genetic mutations at the onset of cultural adaptation may lead to a faster growth rate. In our previous data sets from the Gambia, we did show that cultural adaptation may lead to selection of loss of function mutants. However, we had not measured the multiplication rate. Here, using single genotype isolates, we did identify de novo stop codon mutations in the usual suspects, EPAC and APV2. And they are increasing in frequency over time, so they are being selected for. However, they're not sufficient to explain the increase of parasite multiplication rate in all isolates. So the question remains open, really. Now, let me introduce another data set. For six culture-adapted lines, at day 100, we took three individual clones, which were cultured further and whole genome sequenced at day 200. And that allows us to identify neutral mutations that are found in one and only one clone and that could not have been identified in the bulk genome. I guess a similar approach would have been to use single-cell genomics. But we did find an interesting result. When we compared each clone versus the bulk genome, in clone number two in that specific line, we found that this clone was only sharing 50% identities with the bulk or with the other two clones, meaning that this clone number two is probably a sibling of the main isolates. It's an example of a co-infection. Now let's grab the bull by the horns. As I mentioned with the FWS values, most isolates are polyclonal infections, but the genetic diversity in the flask decreases during culture adaptation. In these five examples, a single genome reaches fixation towards the end of the culture adaptation. However, there are many exceptions, like these three isolates, for which there is evidence of a competition between the genotypes. It's highly dynamic, and no genome reaches fixation at the end of the culture adaptation. So we don't understand why exactly yet, but this is definitely a new area for further investigations. Finally, this data can be analyzed in a GWAS-like manner, because we now have got about 20 genomes that have outcompeted others in vitro. I call them the winner genomes, because they are growing faster. And we can now address this question: what do winner genomes have in common? Are their alleles significantly more represented in these fast-growing genomes? Can we identify new genes whose function is related to growth rate in vitro and potentially virulence in vivo? Unfortunately, my current dataset is too small to detect significant alleles. For that, I believe we will simply need more isolates. But in parallel, we are also performing artificial competition assays between each pair of clones, and this will help us to refine our phenotype. To recap, in bold are the unpublished findings. We show that drug resistance alleles do not bear fitness costs during culture adaptation. From the clones, we identify neutral mutations and siblings from which we can derive the meiotic recombination rate, for example. Also, the culture adaptation does not necessarily lead to fixation. It's a highly dynamic process. And finally, these mixed infections can be turned to our advantage if we use them in a GWAS-like approach to identify novel gene function. And I finally would like to thank all the co-authors involved in this work and my PhD students in IAT for last minute figure. And thank you all for your attention.
Thank you very much, Anton. That was a very interesting talk.